Are you glad to be at church today? I'm glad to have you at church today. Thanks for being here. Want to give a couple quick shout outs if I could. The first, if you attended our marriage conference last weekend, man, that was our first crack at it since I've been here. But would you just show some love to my team? I feel like they did a good job putting that thing together. Pastor Jeremy did a good job leading that team. And I also, I want to give a shout out to y'all, all right? Because last weekend was Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, and we honored him. I invited my pastor here, and let's just be real with one another. He gave us a tough word, didn't he? Yeah, and I think that it was a good word, but it was a tough word, and we've been getting a lot of feedback, and a lot of conversations are happening, and so I just want to say to you, man, I love y'all. I'm so proud of you for the way that you handled that. You guys leaned into those conversations. Some of you left here like, finally, and some of you left here like, I don't know what to do. And you handled that with a lot of maturity and with a lot of grace. And I believe that God's going to bless that, and God's going to continue to unite us. And if we can't lament together and celebrate together, we got a deficiency, right? And so thank you for your kindness to my pastor. Thank you for the conversations that are happening. We're going to continue to lean into that and continue to show the world that folks from different places can be united, right? Okay, that was a little weak. Can we show the world that? All right, fantastic. All right, well listen, I'm going to have you get in your Bibles to the book of Esther. The book of Esther. We are going to start a new series today, Esther, the Hiddenness of God. And this is an exciting book for me. This is really the first book that I get to teach to you. And what I mean is not the first book that I get to preach to you. Okay, so I'm probably going to say, come on somebody, a couple times. When I'm preaching, I say it a lot. It's funny because y'all on my Facebook page, it was my birthday. I don't know when, I'm getting old. I can't even remember when my birthday was. And y'all are like, come on, somebody, happy birthday. And I was like, wow, I must say that a lot. So as we're teaching our way down through it, this is a space for you to lean into the text, for you to lean in to the scripture. And so I want to encourage you, we're essentially going to do a chapter a week. We're going to be in this for 10 weeks up until Easter Sunday, which is April 1st. Just be thinking about who you're going to be inviting to that and praying for, but for 10 weeks. And so if you just read Esther chapter 1 this week, take good notes, come back next week, we'll do Esther chapter 2, so on and so forth. But I want to do my best today to kind of set this book up for you, because it's a fascinating book. It's a book that in time is toward the end of the Old Testament, and it's one of only two books that are named after a woman. Does anyone know what the other book in the Bible named after a woman is? Ruth, yeah, come on somebody, Ruth. I just got to get it out of my system, okay? Esther was written in a time that her contemporaries were a dude by the name of Socrates, right? Pericles, who was kind of the father of democracy, and Pythagoras, who came up with a Pythagorean theorem. Come on somebody up in here with Pythagorean theorem. I have no idea what that means, but she was doing her thing during this time. It's a fascinating book. It's also a difficult book. There's no reference to any kind of internal motivation for why God saw fit to give us this book. We don't know. There's no external study. Jesus doesn't say, you know, my girl Esther. He never does that. He does that with Jonah. He does that with other Old Testament characters, but he never does that with Esther. There's no reference to God in this book. Not one reference. No prayer, no vision, no dream, no worship service. There, God appears to be nowhere in the story. And for the first 7 centuries of the church, nobody wrote a commentary on the book of Esther. There are actually theologians and pastors who believe that the book of Esther shouldn't even be in the Bible, because God doesn't appear to show up. It creates a lot of question. There's a lot of difficulty in it. But here's what we're going to hang our hat on today. We're going to hang our hat. Whoops, apparently there was some. We're going to hang our hat that all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. And so we're going to come to this book, the book of Esther. And let me tell you just pastorally why I wanted to teach this. The book of Esther is ultimately about God's perfect work in imperfect circumstances through imperfect people. Does anyone jive with that? I need God to have a perfect work when the world around me feels very broken. And when I look in the mirror, I see a broken man. I need God to be bigger than that. I need God to be more faithful than that. I need God to be more kind to that. I need God's mercy to be new to me this morning. Amen? And so the book of Esther is a time where the people are asking, or when you read the book, you'll think to yourself, man, why is this happening? Has anyone ever been there in your life? Why is this happening to me, man? Why is God allowing this to happen? And by the way, where is he? Where is God? Nobody else seems to be going through this. This seems to be unique to me. We are going through a 21 days of prayer on our staff. We're going to be doing it as a congregation here before too long. But I said to him, anytime you start praying, just expect to have bad days. Amen? Anytime you kind of stick your head into that spiritual warfare, expect the enemy to respond. And the book of Esther is a woman, is a circumstance, is a time where God's people are living in a circumstance that is devoid of God, and things are happening to them that they can't say, oh, God's doing that, or oh, this is why God's doing that. And what I want to show to you through the book of Esther is that God's providence and care for you is good and kind and faithful even when you can't see it. That's a great spot for an amen. You say, you haven't even taught us the book yet, man. Don't be asking us to amen already. God's care for you is good and helpful. God's care for you is powerful even when you can't see it. And there are times in your life, maybe right now, maybe in the past, maybe in the future, where you can't see God, you can't see his hand, you can't see his work, you can't see his faithfulness. And the book of Esther is a perfect book for you. And so what I want to do is I want to introduce you to some of the characters in the book today, and I want to teach you what I think the intent in that first chapter for the author of Esther is. We don't know who the author of Esther is. Some people think it was Mordecai. Some people think it was a Jewish rabbi. Some people, they just have no idea. But let me show you some of the characters. Here we go. Number one, the first character is God's people. God's people, the Jews. The book of Esther happens in time between Ezra chapter 6 and Ezra chapter 7. If you read through the book of Esther, there's about a 58-year gap between those two chapters, and in the book of Esther fits in between that space. God's people have been sent back by Cyrus to rebuild their temple, led by a dude by the name of Ezra. Some of them have gone, most of them have not, and the rebuilding of the temple is not going very well. If you read the book of Ezra up into chapter 6, things are not going very well. And so God's people are displaced and in transition. Some of them have gone back to the Holy Land. Some of them have said, no, I'm just going to do my thing here. I'm going to live my life here. I'm going to fit in here, and I'm going to serve this guy, a guy by the name of Ahasuerus. Now, Ahasuerus is the name that's referenced in the book of Esther, but we know that history teaches us that his name was Xerxes. Xerxes is a dude that you probably heard of if you've seen the movie 300. I'm not recommending that you should see the movie 300, all right? But if you've seen the movie 300, the Persian king in that movie is this cat right here, Xerxes. Xerxes is the son of Darius I. So let me put you kind of on the map in regards to the Bible. Darius is the guy who threw Daniel into the lion's den. And so this is his boy. Darius was killed as he tried to overtake the city of Athens, and Xerxes would have been picked from a bunch of kids to build on top of what his father had done. You have to understand that in the Persian monarchy, a king would have had a lot of wives and a lot of girlfriends. Come on, somebody. Yeah, see, that was a sketchy one, right? You don't know what you're supposed to say. Yeah, I don't know, right? A lot of wives and a lot of girlfriends, and the idea was for him to create as many offspring as possible so that then the next king could have been picked out of the largest litter, if that makes sense. And so you have to understand that Xerxes was picked. He was the cream of the crop from Darius's offspring, and he would have been picked to build on top of what his dad had started. And so Xerxes was a guy, the Bible tells us that he ruled over 127 provinces. The Bible says from India to Ethiopia. He would have ruled from modern day Iran, if that makes sense. His capital that we're going to see of Susa was about 150 miles north of the Persian Gulf head. So if you're thinking, if you can picture that map, he's a little bit offset into Iran, about 150 miles north of the Persian Gulf, and he's ruling over this enormous expanse of people, millions and millions of people. Xerxes is very simply the most powerful cat in the entire world. Okay, the president of the United States pales in comparison to this kind of guy. We always think about the president as the leader of the free world. This dude was the leader of the whole world, if that makes sense to you. And so we're introduced to him at the very beginning this Ahasuerus, and the Bible says to us that he's seated on a throne in Susa. Susa is modern-day Iran. It's where Nehemiah was the cupbearer for Artaxerxes. If you read the book of Nehemiah, and he's talking about being the cupbearer, he's hanging out in Susa. It's also in Daniel chapter 8, the place that Daniel had a vision from, and it's probably the place that Daniel was buried, modern-day Susa. The actual rendering of it today is Shush. Can you imagine if you were from, hey man, where are you from? Shush. What? No, that's where I'm from. I wasn't telling you to be quiet, right? Modern day Shush is in ancient days Susa, about 150 miles north of the Persian Gulf, and it's the place that royals would have wintered. It was Darius's favorite palace because it was the one that was the most opulent and made him look the best. And so what happens is Darius goes and he gets killed in battle. They pick Xerxes to be his heir, his kind of follow-up king. And Xerxes, in the third year of his reign, is seated on this throne in Susa. If you're reading it during this, it's like the White House times a billion, okay? And the story starts with Xerxes seated on this throne in Susa. Now, here's what you need to understand. The palace in Susa was the most fertile region in all of Iran. There's mountains and streams everywhere. It's a citadel, so it's a fortress, but it's also an acropolis. It's about 120 feet higher than anything else. And so you have to picture the most powerful man in the world sitting at an elevated place, looking out onto absolute beauty and opulence. He is surrounded by what was called the immortals. That was the 10,000 warriors who were the most, it's like Navy SEALs times, hey, we got any Navy SEALs up in here? Okay, good. Navy SEALs times 10, all right? I don't want any Navy SEALs like grabbing my thumb and ripping it off or anything in Guest Central. Like the most elite, he's surrounded by opulence, he's protected, he's rich. History tells us he's incredibly good looking, and he's sitting in the middle of all of this, and the Bible tells us that he has a party. Come on, somebody. If you're rich and you're good looking and you're powerful, what do? You throw parties and you invite Jay-Z to open for you, okay? You invite Michael Jackson back from the dead to sing. Yeah. He throws a party. Now, here's what you need to understand. Xerxes' father had been defeated in battle, and so it was the responsibility of Xerxes to avenge his father's death. And so he's planning. The history actually tells us that he's completely obsessed with defeating the Greeks. If you watch the movie 300, he is going to attack who? The Greeks. And that 300 Spartans kind of impede him for a little bit of time. He ultimately goes and he wins, but he's kind of humiliated because of how long it takes. But this party that gets thrown at the beginning of Esther chapter 1, the king invites anybody who is anybody for a six-month party. Come on, somebody. A six-month party. You're like, man, that was the craziest night of my life until tonight, right? Yesterday was the craziest thing I've ever seen tonight, over and over and over and over again. In those, some of you are like, woo, I got to get out of church so I can stop it. Sit down, all right? Sit down. It's a king's generosity and a king's wealth. He was generous to show off his wealth to show that he was better than everybody. And so the king says, I'm going to let you drink my wine. I'm going to let you hang out in my best castle, my best citadel at the highest place in the best part of land. And we're going to do it. We're going to party like it's 1999 over and over and over again. Those who would have been invited for the military side of thing was about 15,000 people. And so for 6 months, here's what happens. The king shows off. I'm rich, I'm good looking, I'm powerful, and he's trying to leverage the political side of it so that people will give him more taxes so that he can go to war with the Athenians. And so for 6 months, you've got all of this political leveraging, you've got Congress actually working. Come on, somebody. Yeah? Come on, man. It's ridiculous. That's not even a political statement. That's a commonsensical statement. I'm going to stop right there so I can keep my job. So for 6 months, he's like, eat my food, drink my wine, then give me glory, give me worship, give me what I want. That's what's going on in this incredible party. There comes a point at which 6 months into it, 7 days after that 6 months, the king opens up the palace gates for everyone, and anyone who lived in Susa could come and could drink, and it was just a complete show off, right? And a complete arrogance, and a complete pretentious, just ridiculous show of give me glory, give me glory, give me glory, give me glory. There comes a point at which the Bible says that the king is merry in his heart, which means he's drunk out his mind. And he says, go get my wife so that people can see how hot my chick is. That's the translation, okay? Now this is where the story gets kind of interesting, because the king is intending to leverage the beauty of his wife for two reasons. One is so that the people will give him what he wants, which is a war with the Athenians, and so that people will say, any dude who could have a lady like that must be awesome. It's more glory. It's more glory. It's more glory. And what does the queen say? What your wife says. Come on, somebody. She's like, I ain't coming out. The queen had been throwing her own party. We know historically and biblically that the queen would have thrown her own banquet. And so the king throws a six-month party and then a seven-day party. In the middle of that 7 days, he says, come out so that everyone can see how big of a stud I am. And the queen says, I'm not coming. Now, what's interesting about this is that you have this tug of war, right? You have the king who says, give me glory and I'll use you for my glory. And the queen says, I want my own glory. I'm not going to give you yours. And so the king does what you have to do if you're in the middle of a glory grab. You have to take somebody else's glory so they don't take yours first. And so what does he do? He essentially divorces her. He essentially says, if you're not going to come this time, don't ever come again. In chapter 2, he does a mass kidnapping, essentially, to find a new wife. And that's where Esther comes into the picture. But here's where I want to kind of hang on the rim of this. The first thing that's interesting about this is that we're living in a time where God appears to be nowhere in the picture. We have chosen, especially in these United States, to kind of push God out of the narrative. And you have to understand that when you push the one who is most worthy of glory out of the narrative, that there is a glory vacuum. And when that glory vacuum occurs, we all have to try to grab our glory before somebody else grabs theirs. What do you think, honestly, social media is? It's look at me, look at me, look at, no, look at me, no, look at me, no, no, yeah, me. All of the things that are going on in our world right now have to do with the glory vacuum of us removing God from the narrative and us trying to figure out how am I going to get mine because God doesn't get his. It's the same story that has always been when you take God out of the picture. You can change the details, you can change the name, you can change the palace, you can change the location. You take God out of the picture, there's a glory grab, and I got to stomp on you to get mine. That's what's happening in the book of Esther. And what I need you to see is that there are some of God's people who said, I am going to go back to the Holy Land so that I can give God glory from the place that he intended me to give it to him from. And there are others who said, I'll stay here and play the game. And that's always the question for a Christian in a context that there is a glory grab. Will I continue in spite of the culture to choose to give God glory with everything that I have and everything that I am? Or will I just go along with the culture and play the game of the glory grab? And so I got to dress a certain way, talk a certain way, live a certain place, make a certain amount of money, have a certain amount of followers, get a certain amount of attention. You see why the book of Esther is relevant? The book of Esther is like any time in any country where the king, it doesn't matter who's in the White House, where the king is not intent on giving the King of Kings the glory that he deserves. Now, the book of Esther starts in an interesting way because it gives a lot of emphasis to this incredibly powerful king. It gives a lot of emphasis to this opulent palace. It gives a lot of emphasis to the riches and the wealth. It gives a lot of emphasis on where the culture is at the time. And yet there's this significantly glaring thing that's missing from the story of a book of the Bible. And what is it? It's God. Right? It's God. The book of Esther starts by making a big deal out of an earthly king, to the point that you're like waiting for the punchline, waiting for the penny to drop, waiting for, okay, got it. Where's the disciples? Where's the apostles? Where's Jesus? Where's God? And he never shows up. And so what I want to do is I want to help you today with what I think is the intent of the author of Esther and what I think is an important thing for you and I. There are times in our culture and in our life where there's a lot of busyness in the picture, right? There's a lot of voices, there's a lot of angles, there's a lot of visions, there's a lot of dreams, there's a lot of things going on. And a lot of times when a lot of things are going on in our life, we can tend to lose God in the middle of it. And so what the author of Esther does is he or she kind of makes a silhouette that's in the shape of where God should be. Does that make sense to you? It's this, the first chapter is the kind of the silhouette of God because it's the most obvious thing that isn't there. And can I tell you, this isn't a unique strategy for the Bible. Let me give you a couple examples. Have you ever read the Old Testament and thought to yourself, this is a lot of rules? I mean, this is a lot of rules. Like, nobody could ever keep all of these rules. Nobody could ever do all of these things. I lose track of how much money I'm supposed to give and how many sacrifices I'm supposed to make, and I can't do this or step this way or wear that or shave the corner of my beard or get tattoos. I can't do so many rules. What's missing from the picture? Grace. What has God done in the Old Testament? The book of Galatians talks about this. He creates a silhouette where grace should be. He creates a desire for you to say, I can't keep all of these rules, man. So many rules, so many sacrifices, so many tithes. I can't do this. And God's like, the empty space is where I am. Does that make sense to you? Let me give you another example. How many of you have ever read the narrative of the crucifixion? It's so brutal. And it's so violent. And the authors of the Gospels go to such great length to talk about the cat of nine tails and the spitting and the punching and the nails and the all. And you read through it. I'll be honest with you. I hate reading through the crucifixion because something in me says, where is the goodness in this? Where is the redemption in this? Where? It's a silhouette for the resurrection. God intends to create a picture in which you are longing for the empty space to be filled with only him. And when you read through the book of Esther, you see this king who is by any account a wicked man, a glory grab, a glory monger. He is doing everything that he can to make himself the most important person in the story. He's taking over countries, he's pillaging, he's doing terrible things, and then you see the queen who is pursuing it in the exact same way, and you say, where is God? God is in the lack. God is in the empty space. Can I tell you? Sometimes you go through a season of your life, and the news is bad again and again and again and again. And the doctor can't give you good news, and the finances are sideways, and you and your wife are disconnected. And there's this space in which you say, where's God? God's in the lack. In the middle of your hurt, the space that God fills, the option for healing, the option for redemption, the option for resurrection is in the lack. And if I'll stop looking at my hurt, I can look at God's healing. But you got to look into the lack. You got to look into the empty space. Some of you, you're walking around right now and you got this innate built-in restlessness, this discontent. You know what I'm talking about? I'm just going, I'm doing my thing. I'm punching the clock. I go home. It's Groundhog Day again and again and again, but without Bill Murray. Can I tell you that you create this world with all these colors and with all this busyness, but there's this empty space because your calling's in the lack. And God will allow you to paint a very ornate picture so that you'll think to yourself, what's missing here? Some of you, you're walking around, you're anxious. You're walking around, you're worried. You're walking around, you're depressed and you're discouraged. Things are going well, but in your heart, things are sideways and you're frustrated. Can I tell you that God is allowing you to paint a picture that has a silhouette that he's missing from so that you'll say, can God truly bring me rest? Your rest is in the lack. And we paint these pictures, and we live our lives, and we do our thing just like Xerxes did, but on a different scale. And the story of our life is, look at all the things we're pursuing. Look at all the things we have. Look at all the glory that we should get. Look at how much you should admire me. And it's busy, and there's lots of things going on, but there's this silhouette that is an empty space in which your Savior, Jesus Christ, lives and exists. Jesus didn't come as a king. He came as a poor man. Remember that? God's comfortable living in the empty space. Do you know that? For some of you, that's a shift. God's comfortable living in the lack. God's comfortable being the last thing that you look for. But for some of us today, the word that I have for you is in the middle of the palaces, in the middle of the opulence, in the middle of the booze and the women and the pursuit and the glory, the silhouette is where God was. The silhouette is where God lives. And for some of you today, you just have been looking in the wrong place for God. You've just been looking in the wrong place. You've been looking in power. You've been looking in affluence. You've been looking in prestige. You've been looking in admiration. God's not in those things. God's in the lack, just like he is in Esther chapter 1. And so if you're reading through the book of Esther, and you are kind of visualizing for yourself, and Esther chapter 1 gives you an incredible descriptive picture of this palace that's up on a hill. It has a lot of white and a lot of purple and a lot of gold. It tells you the kind of cups that they're drinking from. There's a very distinct picture of a king in this story. But I want to show you the silhouette of another king. Can I do that for you today? And I'm hoping that when you look at Xerxes, what you're going to actually see is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords hanging out in the lack. Here we go. The silhouette of a king. Xerxes was the most powerful man on earth. The most powerful man on earth. Nobody would have argued with this. Actually, we know that Xerxes, in order to get across the Persian Gulf so that he could attack Athens, he had them build a bridge. And whenever the bridge failed, he beheaded all of the engineers, and then he sent slaves out to whip the sea for its disobedience. Decaf, brother, right? Can you imagine? Nobody thought, why am I out here? What? The most powerful man on the earth. Jesus is the creator of heaven and earth. You see, you look at Xerxes and you say, look at the power, look at the opulence, and in the lack, Jesus going, I created all of that. I created all of that. Xerxes was a man who claimed to be God. He actually referred to himself as the Son of God. He referred to himself as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's a reason that God had to reclaim that title, because kings for all of time have tried to proclaim themselves to be God in human flesh. And so Jesus comes along, and Jesus shows up, and he is God in human flesh, but he doesn't show up as a king. He shows up as a carpenter. Why? Because God's often in the lack. Xerxes was a man who claimed to be God. Jesus is the God who chose to be a man. Why is the incarnation so powerful? Because for all of time, kings have sat on huge thrones and said, look at me, I'm God. And God shows up and says, I am the King of Kings, but I'll show up and I'll live with you. I'll show up and I'll move into your neighborhood. I'll show up and I'll be tempted, and I'll live in anonymity, and I'll show up and you'll never see me coming, because I'm a different kind of king. Come on, somebody. I'm a different kind of king. Xerxes shows up in the picture, and Jesus is in the lack. He's in the silhouette. Xerxes never tasted poverty or humiliation. Never tasted poverty. Can you imagine? There's no point at which, no millisecond at which in your life you're embarrassed about something. And when you are embarrassed about something, you just kind of explode so that everybody ignores you. He's never humiliated. He never has a day where he wonders what he's going to eat. Never has a day where he wonders if he has the money for the bills. Jesus chose both so that he could identify with you or I. Why is Jesus so beautiful? Why is Jesus so magnificent? Because for all of time, kings, in all of their opulence and all of their power, said, look at me as I know nothing about you. Follow me as I live an entirely different life than you. And Jesus comes to be humiliated, to live in poverty, so that he can say to you, single mom, when you're struggling and you don't have the bills, you don't have the money, I know what it's like to be there, because I'm a good king. He can look at you when you say, nobody cares about me. I don't have any purpose. I'm entirely anonymous. I'm humiliated everywhere they go. Jesus says, I'm the kind of king, I know what that feels like. Xerxes doesn't know anything about that. Xerxes can't lead you. No king can lead you. Why is Jesus the true King of Kings? Because he chose to identify with you and I. He's hanging out in the lack. He's in the silhouette. Xerxes spent his whole life being served. You know where I'm going, don't you? He spent his whole life being served. History lets us know that he didn't even dress himself. He didn't bathe himself. How'd you like that job? His whole life, if someone could have breathed for him, they would have. Everything they did. Hey, Xerxes never said, pass me the fork. His whole life, people were at his beck and call. It's so powerful and so pronounced, but in that silhouette, Jesus became a servant of no reputation. Listen, you're in here today and you say, why should I make a big deal about Jesus? Because the story of every king until Jesus is this. Serve me. And listen, it doesn't matter what their name is or where they're from. Jesus is the only king who says, I'm not going to come as a king. I'm going to come as a servant. I'm going to make myself entirely anonymous, and I'm going to lift you up for my glory. Jesus is hanging out in the lack. Xerxes is a silhouette. You look at, where is God? He's hanging out in that empty space. Xerxes died, and no one worships him. For all his life, he said, I'm the Son of God. I'm the King of Kings. I'm the Lord of Lords. Worship me. I'm going to throw you a party. Worship me. Look at my wife. Worship me. Look at my military. Worship me. And he died, and we moved on. Jesus conquered death and is worshiped by billions. Listen, Xerxes is dead. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. And when you come in here today and you sing the songs that we sang, do you know what you're doing? You're singing to a God who is alive and well. You're singing to a God, you're worshiping a God who didn't drop dead and was forgotten. 2,000 years ago, Jesus showed up, lived a life of servitude and poverty, was humiliated and murdered, and yet you'll still show up and sing praise to him. Why is that? Because he's the true King of Kings and the true Lord of Lords. He's the true King of Kings and the true Lord of Lords. Xerxes had subjects from many nations. This is why last week matters, y'all. Jesus has worshipers from every tongue, tribe, and nation. This is why missions matters, because we want people to know who the true King of Kings is, no matter where they're from, what they look like, or what their economic status is. Because why? Because of who our King is. If Jesus had come and he had been powerful and lived in a palace and ruled with an iron fist, you couldn't say to people far from God in places that are still developing, Jesus knows where you are, loves you, and wants a purposeful redemption in your life. You couldn't say it. You would say, you're here to serve him, even if it benefits you in no way, shape, or form. But Jesus comes as the true King of Kings. He lives in anonymity. He lives in poverty. He's humiliated and murdered. He's put on a cross and killed, only to raise again 3 days later out of the lack, so that all people from every tribe, tongue, and nation, no matter what your background, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, who you voted for or why, you can worship that God. Jesus was in the lack. Jesus is in the silhouette. Xerxes' kingdom came to an end. Come on, somebody. Xerxes' kingdom came to an end. The kingdom of Jesus has no end. Has no end. You say, why'd you run me through this whole thing? Some of you walked in here today and you're like, where is God? Where is God? Why is he letting this happen to me? Why do bad things keep occurring? I feel like God has abandoned me. I feel like God has left me out to dry. I feel like God only cares about himself. What kind of God would let? Can I tell you, God's never out of the picture. Sometimes he's just in the lack. God's never out of the picture. Sometimes you're just not looking in the right place. And our minds and our hearts are so conditioned to assume that a king will be in a palace on a hill instead of in a stable born into poverty. We're so conditioned that the king will say, look at me, instead of saying, I'm here to serve you. We're so conditioned to look in the wrong place that sometimes when the narrative doesn't go how we thought and we can't find God in it, we just assume that he's nowhere to be found. God is always in the story. God is always at work. God always has plans and purposes for you. God always loves you. God's always kind. God's always gracious. God's always faithful. That's what the story of the book of Esther is. And let me just add this. God's never out of the picture, and God's always worthy of glory. God's always worthy of glory. Listen, you look at a king who says, give me glory, and just by demanding glory, they relinquish the right to receive it. Right? Jesus says, I'm going to come, I'm going to move into your neighborhood, I'm going to live the way that you live, I'm going to experience what you experience, I'm going to be a servant, I'm going to lay my life down, I'm going to let you kill me, and then I'm going to raise again and defeat sin and death. I'm going to be raised up for all men to see, and if you choose to give me glory, you'll understand why I created you. You'll understand the purpose that I have for you. You'll understand that it doesn't matter who gets voted for, who gets elected, I'm still the king. You're going to remember and you're going to understand. It doesn't matter where you're from or what your background is or how much money you made last year. I'm still the king. You're going to see God in places that you've never seen him before in the book of Esther. And my hope and my prayer is that in so doing, you'll walk out of here with more hope, with more passion, with more strength, with more faith than you could ever possibly imagine about a story that God never shows up in. Amen? Amen, amen. Stand up. Let me pray for you.